Well, thank you, everybody, for joining us tonight. I am Jackie Spinner. I am an assistant professor of journalism here at Columbia College Chicago. I'm also the Chicago-based correspondent for Columbia Journalism Review. Our event tonight is sponsored by Columbia Journalism Review and the Chicago Reporter and the Columbia College Chicago Library. We are very grateful to them for hosting us for this inaugural bookmark event, and thank you for coming. I want to introduce the panelists and our moderator, and then I'm going to let them get started in having a conversation. This is a conversation, so we invite you to ask questions. We are going to be also listening on Facebook for anybody who has questions, and we'll be taking questions there. We'll also be taking questions via Twitter from the audience. And so this is in no particular order, but Darlene Glanton is a columnist for the Chicago Tribune. Since coming to the Tribune from the Los Angeles Times in 1989, She is particularly focused on issues regarding race, civil rights, and neighborhood violence. In a recent column, she called for a war on poverty to address the violence in the communities where Chicago residents lack basic resources. She also wrote about a mother and son recently in North Lawndale and told us the words from a murdered 8-year-old's diary that haunted her. The quote is, "I'm going to be a beautiful, smart, and good young lady. I can do anything I put my smart mind to. People say I'm smart and courageous and beautiful." Chip Mitchell reports primarily on policing and immigration on Chicago's West Side. He's an award-winning reporter and former foreign correspondent. Last month, Mitchell reported about Police Superintendent Eddie Johnson's reaction to President Trump's call to send in the feds if Chicago couldn't fix its horrible carnage. Johnson told Mitchell that he is glad that Trump recognizes that Chicago has some challenges and asked the president for better jobs, better mental health care, and better education to combat the violence. Jeff Mays, next to Darlene, is the editor of Chicago Sun-Times Breaking News Desk and editor of the Homicide Watch, which is a community-oriented website. This is from Homicide Watch's mission. Homicide Watch Chicago is dedicated to the proposition that murder is never a run-of-the-mill story. Attention must be paid to each one, not merely a select and particularly tragic few. We understand the reality of public's demand for news, that some stories get more attention than others, but all murders represent a degree of human suffering, direct and indirect, that cannot be ignored. Our goal is to tell the story of every murder in the city so that together we might fight the tendency to view homicides as just another rising or falling number like mortgage rates or batting averages. Kimberly Smith, on the end, is a researcher at the Crime Lab, part of the University of Chicago Urban Labs. In a report issued this year, Smith and other researchers examined Chicago's 2016 rise in gun violence to determine reasons for the increase and provide a foundation for policy strategies in the year ahead. The report found that increases in crime from 2015 to 2016 were much larger for gun crimes than for those not committed with firearms. Most of the violence stemmed from altercations in public areas with a gun ready at hand. The violence was highly concentrated, with 5 of Chicago's 77 neighborhoods accounting for nearly half of the increase in the city as a whole. And finally, our moderator tonight is Susan Smith Richardson. She's the editor and publisher of the Chicago Reporter, and a partner, which is our partner with this event. Susan was a Nieman Fellow at Harvard and an award-winning reporter and editor. She still is. Among the places she has worked, she was the managing editor of the Texas Observer and the public education editor in Urban Affairs at the Chicago Tribune. So I'm going to turn it over to Susan now to start our discussion.
Thank you, and thanks for joining us today. What we're going to do is try to have a conversation. I'm going to kick it off with a few questions to the panelists, but I want to go back and forth. I have a few questions, and I want to throw some more questions to you, and let's get a conversation going on about journalism, violence, and how journalists, what responsibilities journalists have in covering violence in Chicago, and how we frame that story. So rather than start with something boring, I want to wake you all up. So I'm going to start with an opinion question. A lot of the premise of this event kind of flows from what the president has said about Chicago. So let me remind everybody about the infamous tweet from earlier this year. If Chicago doesn't fix the horrible carnage going on, I will send in the feds. In the president's first interview, he told ABC's David Muir that Chicago's leaders are not doing the job. Now, if they want help, I would love to help them. I will send in what we have to send in. One author writing about this in The New Yorker said, what the president stated read more like a threat than an offer of assistance. So I want to pose this question to our panelists. Is Chicago a punchline to the president's law and order speech? And from a journalistic frame point, how should we cover his comments about the city's violence?
I don't know that so much we're a punchline for the president. I think we're just an example of what he sees are just the numbers. I don't think he has any idea of what's really happening in the city or as to the cause of this violence. If he thinks that sending in a few extra, whoever he's going to send in, National Guardsmen or whatever, are going to solve the problem, it's not, because the problems are much deeper rooted than just people running around the street shooting. There's reasons that those people are out there shooting. There's reasons that some of those people are getting shot, and the president doesn't understand that. And I also think he's just got it in for Chicago because it's one of the cities that voted most strongly against him. There are ways he can help, but it's not going to be by sending in troops. It's going to be sending in money for housing, money for job creation, money for small business improvements, money for schools, money for that kind of thing that's going to make those neighborhoods better, which I think will in turn make them safer.
Hello. So I've written several columns about what President Trump has said about Chicago. My opinion is very clear that for him, this is really just more politics. It started during the campaign when he was talking about bringing law and order to the cities, without really understanding the relationship, the tense relationship that many people in minority communities have with the police. And he has also made it very clear that his idea of law and order is giving more authority to the police to do whatever they feel is necessary to bring the crime down. And that also means throwing a lot of people in jail and not necessarily providing services that will help the community. So I think he's been very clear on that. And my mission has been, as a columnist, to make people aware of the fact that he's not offering any real help, because people have opened the door to him. Even the mayor said, come on in and bring us some services. People have said that over and over. He doesn't even want to talk about that. He hasn't addressed it. So it's very clear to me.
Yeah, I think it's still obviously very early in his presidency, and we'll see if there are any resources that are put into Chicago to combat the horrendous gun violence that's going on, and it's gotten a lot worse. He's right about that. Things have gotten a lot worse in this town over the last 15 months. It started in January 2016, and March has tapered off a little bit, but it was a terrible winter here in Chicago too, if you adjust the data seasonally in terms of shootings and killings. On the one hand, Chicago does need a lot of attention, and I'm not sure that what Trump has in mind is actually dealing with the problems. If you think the underlying causes of the violence have to do with poverty and segregation and joblessness, especially among young men, especially of those young African American men. You know, I don't see any signs that that is what he has in mind. It could be also that it's just he doesn't have anything in mind, that this is just dog whistle politics, and as Darlene said, you know, he's appealing to a political base. That political base that he has is not here in Chicago. I think it's mainly white working class people, and there could be some appeal to them of thinking of Chicago, you know, only in terms of urban mayhem, and there's a heavy race component to that. So it could be just, you know, maybe that's the only thing going on here. If he's thinking about just, you know, the National Guard or law enforcement and a tougher, you know, a much tougher line here in Chicago, you know, I think there are a lot of questions about that as well. But, you know, we'll see if there's, you know, what's going to happen.
Just to piggyback on what Chip was just alluding to, I think Chicago, you know, objectively had a terrible 2016. Absolutely, the number of homicides in Chicago was higher than in any other U.S. city. When we look at the homicide rate, so per 100,000, however, Chicago is in the middle of the pack, behind cities such as Detroit, St. Louis. So while Donald Trump is correct in that the number of people who died last year in Chicago is higher than in any other U.S. city, it's not a problem unique to Chicago. Violence is occurring in many large U.S. cities. I don't know if it's a punchline or if it's a great way to get people's attention, but it's certainly something that I think his comments have spurred a lot of action within Chicago. People are, I think, responding to his tweets as best as they can regarding, you know, policy reforms and programs that could be introduced with federal support to counteract a lot of the violence. So I think we'll see what happens in the next few months.
So let's tease out the kind of dog whistle politics issue from the actual numbers and the violence that's occurring in the city. So I want to piggyback on what you were saying in terms of some of the statistics from the UC Crime Lab report, which was released in January. So yes, in a broader sense, as Kim was pointing out, Chicago is an outlier in terms of total homicides, but not the homicide rate per capita. So just to name the other cities that are ahead of Chicago, just in terms of smaller cities, but cities that have a higher per capita, Detroit, New Orleans, St. Louis. So the fact that Chicago gets targeted and not those cities is an interesting question. And it poses a tough question for journalists when you're having to cover violence, but also a president's comments around violence. How do you separate the, you know, what could be the dog whistle politics, as you said, Chip, from how you cover the issue of violence? How often are you reactive to what the president is saying? And when do you need to report on it and how? So can we kind of get more to the how of reporting about the violence? Because one thing Jeff was saying earlier is that you're looking at the numbers, and there's a political advantage to playing out the numbers to maybe shout to the base. But what does that mean here in terms of how journalists are covering the violence?
Excuse me. I think one of the problems we have in Chicago, and we're talking about the crime rate in the city being in the middle of the pack. If you look at Chicago closely, 75 to 80, maybe even more of that crime is in a few neighborhoods on the west and the south sides. And I think if somebody did a survey and said, what was the crime rate in Englewood, what was the crime rate in Garfield Park, what was the crime rate in Austin, it's gonna be much, much higher, because you have areas of the city where there basically is no gun violence, and if there is, it's front page news. I think part of the problem with media coverage, at least the mainstream, what they call the mainstream media, which is a bad word now, I know, TV news especially, their advertisers, most of their viewers are in those neighborhoods where you don't have that high crime rate, and they tend to look at those outlying areas of the city, and not really outlying areas, what they would consider outlying areas. they don't cover them as well. They do cover the numbers. I've had this argument with some of the editors at my own paper. I've discussed this with some of the TV people in the city. When the 100th person in Chicago was killed this year, it was a huge story for everybody. Everybody wanted to be the first to get that story out. The same thing will happen when there's 200, 300, however many there are this year. As far as each individual murder is concerned, if you strictly watch the TV news, you probably wouldn't even know about most of them, because unless the victim happens to be a young child or it happens in one of these neighborhoods where there's rarely ever a shooting, or this afternoon, four people just got shot in the last hour at a restaurant in South Shore, that's gonna be the news again tonight. One thing that especially bothered me, and this happened last summer, we had a weekend where there were, I believe, 13 people killed over a four-day holiday weekend. And I watched two of the newscasts on Monday night, and their lead story was a window of a car got shot out in Ravenswood. To them, that was a bigger story than these 13 people that got killed. I think the one thing the president's, and I can I say idiotic statements? Because I still don't think he knows what he's talking about, has done is made everybody look at this a little bit closer, because he's threatening to send in the feds. No one knows what he means by that, but I don't think anybody really wants to see the National Guard in here. I don't think it would do any good if it did, but we're taking a closer look at these numbers, and I think studies like UC did, the University of Illinois Chicago has started a three-year study on the victims of crimes, and they're looking specifically at black males between 15 and 25 who either had family members shot or were shot themselves and survived. That to me will be a much more interesting thing to read than the 100th person just got shot in Chicago. I think all the media needs to look at ourselves and try to figure out, why are we so caught up in the numbers, and why are we so almost nonchalant about the individuals who are being killed here? We just have to change that. If we can change that perspective a little bit and humanize these stories a little bit more, that will have people thinking more and working harder on solutions rather than just making this a political soccer ball that's kicked back and forth between aldermen and the mayor and whoever else is involved.
So I want to kind of ask a follow-up, one for Chip and then one for Darlene. So Darlene, recently, you know, on March 5th, I think it was, you had the story that Jackie alluded to at the beginning about the 15-year-old from North Lawndale and what his day-to-day life was like. Before I ask you a couple of questions about that, I want to come back with a few more statistics so we're putting some things in context about the violence in the city. So, and this is once again coming from the UC Crime Lab report, African American men 15 to 34 were over half of the homicide victims in the city last year, though they are just 4% of the city's population. That's a staggering number. But as I read your story, I thought what you were doing was telling the story of someone who is most at risk of being killed in gun violence. And you even start the story with this young man hearing gunshots and running. So you took us on the ground with that story. As you reported that story and it got behind the statistics to walk in someone's shoes, was there anything you learned there that surprised you about the impact of violence on family, on an individual, on a community?
I don't know that I found anything myself that was particularly surprising, because I've been writing about crime for so long. But the reason I did this piece, and it took me a really long time to do it, I spent several months with his family, really getting to know this young man and his friends, his aunt. I wanted people to understand why young men feel as though they need to carry a gun. And in order to do that, you had to understand the circumstances of where he lives, how he relates to his friends, how he feels about his aunt, and this whole idea of, I am the protector of my family. And I felt if people could really get to know this kid, and I was really, when I was writing it, I really wanted to humanize him in a way that people wouldn't just turn it off and say, oh, you know, this isn't somebody we don't, this is somebody we don't care about. We don't, we can't relate. We wanted people to be able to relate to this kid. And when you talk about the numbers, this is something we struggle with a lot at the Tribune. And I will tell you, the reason we do those daily stories about the murders and the numbers is because that's what people want to read. And they get a lot of clicks. Personally, I have issues with that. I've talked about it in the paper, but you know, that's not going to change. That's going to happen. But we have a responsibility to go behind those numbers, and that's what I try to do as a columnist. We have a whole team of reporters at the Tribune who do nothing but do the bigger picture stories about the crime. So I think what we try to do is balance that. But it's very difficult. It's very difficult because what people concentrate on are the numbers.
So, Chip, you have a bureau and you operate out of a bureau.
That's right.
So does that, you know, there's been a lot of discussion about, well, if there was more embedded journalism, if journalists were more connected to communities, it would help to inform the coverage and maybe even improve some of the coverage. Especially if communities of color and other communities that don't tend to get, that tend to get stereotyped regularly in media. So, as someone who operates in and out of community, does that make an impact? Does it make a difference in terms of what you're seeing and what you're picking up on in terms of how you report stories?
Yeah, it makes a difference. So I have to admit that, you know, I spend a lot of days in the bureau. It's not like every day I'm going out and canvassing and meeting new people in their homes and hanging out with kids in the neighborhood and stuff like that. So it's just, you know, I have to produce work. I have a lot of work at the courthouse nearby the bureau, and my job has actually shifted, you know, over the last three years from being focused kind of on the west side, mm-hmm. to being, I'm a now full-time criminal justice. So now, that being said, you know, where I work and where I commute to and from the office and the stories that I tend to focus on, even, you know, even though I'm reporting mainly about the Chicago Police Department, being on the west side, yeah, it helps a lot and it influences me. And, you know, I work on a block that has, something about my block is there is prostitution out front almost every day when it's not, you know, extremely cold. And that is something that, you know, I it's on my mind, you know, and I talk with the women I look at and sometimes get a word in with the men that are the bosses. So I have closer relationships with the police officers that work on the west side, and yeah, it makes a big difference. I think, you know, at WBZ we need more people. We have four bureaus. We need more people working in them, you know, in all, not just in criminal justice, but in all the areas of reporting that we do. And I think that all of the major media, you know, news outlets could, yeah, definitely stand to benefit from spending more and more time, is, you know, maxing out the time and building, you know, facilities, figuring out a way to station reporters in these neighborhoods. Definitely, you know, what can I say? How can it not be a good thing?
Let me throw it to the audience. Is there a question? Yes.
When you're writing your column, what audience do you have?
He asked when I'm writing my column, what audience do I have in mind? The Tribune audience, to be honest, which is basically white middle class, Chicagoans, a lot of suburban nights. Because, and here's why. I think that solving crime, it has to be a citywide, even maybe even statewide effort. I'm not even sure at this point. But we can't just leave it to the people who live in the communities because they don't have the resources to do it. We need everybody to get behind our mayor and push, you know, the aldermen to do whatever they can to bring economic development to these areas, job training and jobs and things like that. And so I want people who don't live in the communities that are affected to really understand why this is the problem beyond just the numbers, beyond just how it's generational, how if we don't deal with this now, that it's going to affect us in this city for a very long time to come. And so I am almost always talking to those people.
Now, I want to ask, thank you for the question, ask that of everybody here, because that is always kind of the dilemma. You have to be clear about the audience, whether, you know, you think you should be able to write it a different way. The point of storytelling when you're at, you know, a place like the Tribune, or you probably experience the same thing at BEZ, or at the Sun-Times, is that you are trying to give people an experience they don't have. But the other point of doing what we do is we just don't do it because we like the pretty words. We're in it also because we do hope that we identify issues and can help move issues. But it's very different when you have to frame a story for an audience, for the Defender and the audience at the Tribune. How are you thinking about that when you're putting a story together? I want to ask Chip this question. Oh. And then Jeff, the same thing.
Well, you know, I think all over, you know, throughout the you know, the ranks, you know, the world of professional journalists, this is, you know, how we frame our stories and how has Trump's election affected our work? I think that, is that what you're asking? I mean, that's what the title of the panel, right?
It is, but also there's been an ongoing issue long before Trump showed up about how we frame coverage and who are we writing to, which is essentially the question I'm asking, and how much you think about how you are communicating to the audience for your news organization.
I think about it a lot. You know, I think our audience is probably a lot like the Tribune's, and you know, and it's not, you know, the people that are listening to public radio are not the same people that I'm reporting about. So that right there raises an issue about voyeurism, and it can be. I think that the people that I'm talking to on the air and who actually are listening, I think they care about the issues, and I have a strong, you know, feeling about that. Definitely, the people that are paying for the station, you know, we have a different funding model than a lot of news operations. I think it's a good one. I think that they care about the community and the issues I report about. But it's there's no doubt that, you know, demographically they're not representative. You know, they're tending to be older and whiter and more educated and so on. They also tend to be more liberal. And I'm reporting about policing, and that I think makes it difficult. You know, public radio has a reputation. It's hard to get cops to talk, and I think it's important to hear cops, especially now more than ever, given the violence that's going on, and given this election that we had. You know, the Fraternal Order of Police nationally endorsed Trump. The head of the president of Lodge 7 here just was in Washington meeting with Trump administration officials, and he said that, you know, this president has our backs, And from my talking with police here, you know, I haven't been able to take a poll, but I would say that a lot of them think Trump is right on. You know, mm-hmm. So I think that we need those voices on the air, and it's. I would say that, you know, I don't consider my reporting to be against Trump or countering mm-hmm. Trump or mm-hmm. anything like I think my reporting is about what's going on in Chicago mainly. And of course, we have a national context that includes Trump mm-hmm. right now. And so I don't know where I'm going right now. But yeah, I think about these issues about audience a mm-hmm. lot.
Let me ask Jeff about that, because we were talking earlier about just the role of homicide watch is to be able to capture the stories of everyday folks with the premise that every life matters. So when you think about how you're framing your stories, your point is to be very clear about telling stories of everyday people that you think may not get into the daily coverage.
I learned very early when I took over Homicide Watch that the audience that is reading those stories is a 180 degree chain difference from the people that are reading the Sun-Times. Because some of those stories, I'll take a Sun-Times story and change it a little bit. And I will realize from the comments that those people had never seen these stories before. A lot of people had never seen these stories before. The Homicide Watch audience is much smaller. It's much more targeted to those areas where the crime is happening, because that's the people that are affected and those are the people that want to read these stories. Whenever we talk for the Sun-Times and we put the police side of the story in, probably 75% of the murders in the city, police will either say the suspect or the victim was a gang member. It's just, and you don't know where this comes from, but it's just like a standard line that the police throw in. I will never say that on Homicide Watch, because I know that the way the police are getting some of this information is from their old gang books, or a kid got in trouble once because he was hanging out with some kids and they were gang members, so now this kid's a gang member because he's hanging out with gang members. Those people don't care about that. They realize that a lot of the people in those neighborhoods are gang members. They don't want that. They know that. They also, it's an audience that is very distrustful of the police, that is very distrustful of the media. I think it's almost certainly a less affluent, less educated audience that's reading this. It's not that you have to talk down to them, but you have to, if some of the questions you ask, you have to be very ginger about it. I will always ask if the person who was killed was a gang member. I mean, if they want to talk about it, and a lot of the parents do. A lot of the parents will say, yes, he grew up in a neighborhood. All of his friends have been gang members since he was 4 years old. He was not in the gang, but he hung out with these kids. He doesn't have a choice. I let them do the talking. I don't want to get into those areas, because a lot of times if you ask the wrong question, that's it. They're going to hang up on you. I've had a lot of people that I've talked to. There was a woman I talked to for 2 hours once. It was the mother of a young man who got shot. I believe he was 17. I also spoke with his sister. And the day before the story was to go out, the father called and said, no. No story. Hmm. I think that a lot of this is, these people want to talk. They want to talk, but they don't especially want those stories out there because they're afraid. A lot of these people are just living in fear, and I think that's the biggest part of this whole thing that the Sun-Times audience just doesn't understand, because they can't relate to living somewhere where you're almost afraid to go out in the street at night. Hmm. You're afraid when you send your kids to school in the morning whether they're going to come back. And you just have, it's an audience that lives, like I said, almost a whole different world from what's happening to the readers of the Sun-Times.
What do you do when they ask? When they ask, no story.
I don't run it. I just don't run it. There's no point in doing it, and it's just, like I said, it's going to be offensive to those people, and they're going to tell their neighbors, and they're going to, you know, I have a very good rapport with a lot of people. There are about probably 14,000-15,000 people who follow that site religiously. Mm-hmm. I know a lot of them by names. I talk to them on the phone. I talk to them, you know, email or not email, but through the comments. The comments on the Homicide Watch page run the whole gamut. A lot of it's, yeah, I knew him. He was a great mm-hmm. kid. Then you have the ones who, oh, no, he was, you know, a lot of them I delete right away. There's the standard group of racist white guys who follow these sites and make their idiotic comments. Mm-hmm. You delete those. But, yeah, if someone tells me they don't want a story, I just don't do it. A lot of people will call and talk, and they'll say, I don't want a story. I just want somebody to listen to what I'm saying. I had a woman call me. She was an elderly woman. She had witnessed the shooting on her street corner, and she was literally afraid to walk outside of her door. And I didn't really know what to tell her. She didn't want her name in the paper. She didn't want me to say anything about it. She just wanted somebody to know what was going on. And I happened to mention it to a police officer next time I talked to them that, you know, maybe keep an eye on that block, you know, because it's hard at times to deal with people that are hurting so badly, and they don't really want to talk to you. They want to talk to anybody.
Yeah. I mean, I think that's such a powerful point, because we don't often write about just the pain that's there. And we also get a lot of calls from people who just want to be heard. You know, which is so basic. Everybody wants to be heard. And the part of the emotional reality of living with violence is the part that, you know, in a daily story and a statistic story, you can't capture. But I want to piggyback on something Darlene said and ask him about this. Darlene had mentioned, so when she's writing, she's thinking about how am I talking to people who don't live in that community, who are outside of the community I may be writing about in the case of the 15-year-old young man. There was a study that came out this week from the Metropolitan Planning Council, The Cost of Segregation, and it set that very point you mentioned, Darlene. It's important for the region and the city to care about this, and to feel that somehow they have a vested interest in what's happening. And a lot of the statistics in the report, it attempted to quantify, so what is the cost to the region? Which means everybody, I don't care if you live in Schaumburg or you live in the Austin neighborhood. So coming to that point, Kim, just talk to us a little bit more about the numbers of the neighborhoods that are most affected by the violence in the city, and kind of bring people up to speed with some of the more important statistics about where the violence has been concentrated.
So we looked at the distribution of homicides and shootings in Chicago by community area and also by police district. Unsurprisingly, homicides and shootings are concentrated in west and south side neighborhoods, where upwards of 25% of the population are living below the poverty line, and high school graduation rates are lower than in other parts of the city. I think what we tried to convey with that point is that homicide and violent crime in Chicago is concentrated in already disadvantaged areas. And in order to tackle the problem, we need to invest a lot of money in these areas, tens, hundreds of millions of dollars potentially. Beyond, if you look at the most dangerous community area or similar type of geographic region in Los Angeles and New York, Chicago's most dangerous areas far outweigh anything you would see in another major U.S. city, such as L.A. or New York. So just the degree of to which violence is segregated in Chicago was, I think, quite startling for us as researchers. And a lot of the increase in violence was similarly concentrated in those areas. In 2016, it wasn't it wasn't as if, you know, Chicago as a whole saw community areas saw an increase. It really was concentrated in areas that were already predominantly violent.
So the interesting thing about the UC Crime Lab report, though, is you have a lot of information on who's right. being affected, because I think the five neighborhoods with the greatest increase last year, Austin was one of them. I've forgotten the other neighborhoods, but I think two were on the west side, three may have been south side. When there's so much information on the who, mm-hmm. why was there no, you know, there were no policy recommendations that came out of that? There's a lot of information, but mm-hmm. the why still, you know, was not addressed in the report, because, you know, you and the other researchers said they're kind of confounded by the why. So where do we go with this
information? Where do we go with this? Certainly we were not disappointed, but perplexed at the fact that we were not able to definitively isolate one cause or explanation as leading to the sudden and persistent increase in violence in 2016. But it was a very useful exercise looking at the who and the even where and when are homicides occurring, in which neighborhoods, which age range. Did the characteristics of homicide in 2016 differ significantly from 2015? No, that was not the case. The victims were still predominantly African-American males, disproportionately outweighing their population weight in Chicago. So I think the lack of policy prescriptions in the actual report was done so as not necessarily because we don't have an idea of things that might work. We just kind of wanted to produce some sort of comprehensive deep dive at, you know, these are the candidate explanations that are typically given to explain violence in Chicago, and they've consistently been applied to explain the surge in 2016. While we weren't able to conclude that, you know, any one thing was the cause of the, you know, almost 60% increase year to year, I think that doesn't mean we should be paralyzed in our response. There are, as you said in the in your question, there are many. We took a look at who was affected by homicide and who the offenders of, you know, gun violence were in Chicago, and I think that gives us an idea of who to target social services toward. The narrative, I believe, is that, you know, it's a lot of young teenage boys, so heavily invest in after-school programs and jobs. And while I think that is certainly a part of the solution, when you look at the offenders of homicide and the victims, there's still a large share of men over 20 who are dying and who are committing these crimes. So any sort of policy response will need to focus, you know, beyond just high school outreach or after school programs. It will need to tackle that also, you know, over 20 population. And I think that's something that we are still trying to flesh out. What does that look like exactly? Because it's counter to the narrative that I think a lot of people have. So the answer is we have some of a solution. We know that there are certain programs that work to decrease violence and increase, for example, high school graduation among disadvantaged and populations who are likely to be victims or perpetrators of crime. But as you saw in the report, that is still just a portion of those who are falling victim. So we're working on it, I would say, at the University of Chicago.
So just for Chip and Darlene and Jeff, I mean, there's a lot of conversation about how journalists should cover solutions. You know, should we cover best practices, and how should we do it? There's a whole group now that's started called the Solutions Journalism Network, and the whole point is to not just cover a problem, but also to cover maybe a good example that a program that's attempting to address that. What is the responsibility? Is there a role of journalists to cover solutions? Which means we're not starting with, I'll tell you about the problem, but I'm going to go to name a program in the city and a program that has, you know, results and cover that program. So are we in the business of also covering solutions?
I can tell you that every time I write a column about the violence, I get tons of emails from people wanting to know if there's a particular program they can volunteer with or donate money to or something like that. I am very uncomfortable recommending specific programs because I haven't researched programs and I don't, you know if there are ones that we would want to support or not. But I do think that we have a responsibility to give people some answers. The first thing I will say is I don't know the answer. I don't know how to solve this problem. I don't know that anybody does, really. I don't think the mayor does. I don't think anybody does. But what I encourage people to do is to voice and to talk about it. And one of the things that I pushed for recently was for a meeting of for the the city to hold community meetings in all 50 wards, so that people could talk about how they view solutions, at what they feel can be done. I think the people who live in the neighborhoods probably have the best idea of how to solve some of these problems. And I was very happy that last week the mayor's office announced that through the police advisory board, they are going to be holding 3 community hearings across the city where people can talk about these kinds of things. So that's better than nothing. So, that's the obligation I think we have as journalists to put the information out there and, let people figure how they want to deal with it.
Yeah, I think journalists should be looking at solutions. There's not a silver bullet or even, just a handful of silver bullets, bronze bullets. I think that there's probably a package of short-term approaches to deal with the sudden and sustained increase in gun violence that we've seen in the last 15 years. One thing in the crime lab that you all pointed out, which is a fascinating idea, is it's important to try to identify some of the causes of that sudden increase. And we can talk about sort of the open questions that you guys left some key things, kind of dangling out there. It's like, we don't know. Gang fragmentation, the role of social media, drug markets, some things that I would say that were not really addressed by the report much were, what had been called the Ferguson effect here in Chicago. We might call it the Laquan effect, and I'm not just talking about police engagement and that longer contact card, and cops in what has been called a defensive crouch. I'm talking about that, and I'm also talking about a crisis in public confidence in the police after that video, and how that sets a lot of that activates a lot of deep-seated, bad sentiment about the police in the communities where this violence is taking place, and that, that leads to cycles of violence. So it's, even if we can sort of, we have a hunch about some of these things, the solutions aren't necessarily, Jens Ludwig at your outfit was putting it, the solutions aren't necessarily the exact opposite of those causes. So that it may be that to deal with the sudden increase, it's things like street mediation. The group that has made a big deal out of this is Cure Violence, formerly known as Street Ceasefire. Jobs, this city program One Summer Chicago has been studied and apparently is really effective on crime. Well, why aren't there the resources to scale that thing up, a lot, like until it really actually has an impact? If it's so effective with this small number of at-risk kids, 10,000 of them, why not scale it up to 100,000? And then what about jobs for adults, as you're saying? It's not just young people that are in trouble with the violence. You know, same thing for mentorships. Why not on a much bigger scale? I've never been, I've always been suspicious about looking at guns as a source. But, you know, maybe there is something to what police officers are saying, which is that they keep arresting the same guys over and over on gun offenses. And why aren't they being held longer, in our judicial system? So I think there probably are some leading candidates for some short-term approaches, a package of them, and I think we as journalists have to report on that because we have, it's our city. We have to report on these things, and things are out of control. And then I think we also have to look at more medium and long-term solutions. Police accountability is on the, there. Obviously, residential housing segregation, poverty, education. Working with parents, I think, is another thing that that may not be popular to talk about, but there's a whole bunch of stuff that we have an obligation to scrutinize in terms of not just what's happening yesterday, last week, what some of the causes are, but what some of the solutions might be.
Jeff, do you want to respond to that? And then we're going to go to the audience.
I agree with everything Chip just said. There is no easy answer to this. I think part of the problem with media is when we're looking for solutions, we look to the civic leaders and see what they're saying about the answers. And I really don't think the people at City Hall have the right answers. The people who live in these communities, they want more police there. They want more police cameras there. I don't know if anybody remembers, not last summer, but the summer of 2015, there was a series of incidents, two or three, where tourists got their cell phones grabbed downtown by groups of teenagers. Mm-hmm. For a month after that, you could not walk down a street on Michigan Avenue or Ohio, that area, without bumping into a police officer on every single corner. But there can be a series of murders on this afternoon, there were five murders on 75th Street. You're not going to see a cop on every corner on 75th Street for the next month. Mm-hmm. It just doesn't happen. The police are utilized where the city thinks the money is. That's mm-hmm. just a fact. No one's going to say that. The police aren't going to tell you that. But if something happens downtown, there's going to be police swarming everywhere. When there's a murder down in Englewood, the Englewood District Police are going to be there, and that's going to be it. And the people that live in those neighborhoods realize that. They know that. They want more police down there. The distrust of the police, yes, has grown with the release of these videos. But they also know that they need them. And last year, one of the state reps made some comment about she thought the police were doing a lot of these murders. And the people on Homicide Watch were laughing. These people I talk to all the time said, that's the stupidest thing they ever heard. Who is this woman and why is she saying this? She's not doing any good. But the politicians say what they want to get their headlines. We're gonna fix this, we're gonna fix that. But they're not addressing the bigger issue. And like he said, there's a lot of things down there going that they need jobs. They need the neighborhoods improved. They need those houses even prettied up some. They need the streets improved. I mean, they probably have spent more money on the bike path than they have on roads in some of those neighborhoods. It's absurd. Whenever something has to be done downtown, they can find the money for it. But when these aldermen in those wards out there are begging for money, we just don't have the money for that. And the other thing that I think has really led to a lot more of this problem, and I don't know, Rick Talender, who's one of our sports guys, just did a long series on the Orr basketball team, which is in the Humboldt Park, Garfield Park. That's kind of where those kids come from. Garfield Park is one of the worst, I think, probably in one of those five that you were talking about. Those kids, he spent the whole basketball season talking with these kids. The one thing they said that got to me was they looked to the school as the place that they could go to feel safe. They didn't feel safe outside. They didn't feel safe getting to school. They didn't especially feel safe at home. They felt safe at school. But the money for the schools in the cities, the schools they closed were in those same neighborhoods where the violence is shooting up. Now those kids have nowhere to go. I mean, they've got people lining the streets in the morning just so these young kids can walk to school and feel safe. I think that's one of the things that has to be addressed is the CPS problems. And again, CPS has turned into a political football. The mayor's got his ideas and the city, the school board is all on, you know, they're his handpicked people. They're gonna do what they want. But whenever money gets tight, you can almost guess which schools are going to take the hits there.
I want to talk a little bit, and I want to kind of save this for the last question, because you're talking about the intersection of crime with all these other issues, and poverty with a whole bunch of issues. That's a big issue. And in journalism on the day-to-day, it doesn't get covered that way, because people are focused on beats. A nice Sunday story, a larger read may try to be comprehensive, which the example we used of Darlene's story of putting someone in an entire, you know, history of a family that migrated here. But covering systemic racial and economic, you know, discrimination is not necessarily the strong suit of right. journalism. So you're kind of speaking to that point. But I want to come back and ask folks to talk a little bit more about that. But I want to pull the audience in and get any comments or questions. Yes.
So I've been exploring some of the police law enforcement data. And so we know that Chicago had the highest per capita murder rate increase from 17.5 to about 27 in the US. Chicago also has the highest officer per 100,000. So with the
highest number of officers
per
100,000
rate at like 470 in the U.S. So CPD just released a statement saying that they're gonna hire 1,000 more officers. Is more officers what Chicago needs? Is we're already the highest per capita officer and we have the highest murder rate, or do we need to allocate those resources to the social problems that we're looking at?
I'm not an expert on this, so I'm going to pass this along.
Kim, but what do you think?
Yeah, I think it's where they allocate those new officers is going to be the important thing. Are they going to put them where they're needed, or are they going to put them where it's politically popular? When there's, I mean, there can be a shooting in Andersonville, and the alderman is screaming, we don't have enough cops, we don't have enough cops, even though they probably have one of the lowest crime rates in the city. So...
When I'm not helping with the Chicago University of Chicago Crime Lab report, I'm assisting with a new project the Chicago Crime Lab has embarked on. We are embedding analysts such as myself in the police districts that are most adversely affected by crime. So I'm currently based on the West Side in the Harrison District, which comprises of East Garfield Park, parts of Humboldt Park, and North Lawndale. And this is just anecdotally, I can say that during the summer or even on a very busy night, officers are just responding to calls and don't have much quote-unquote downtime. So in that respect, I feel they imagine any additional help is very welcome. If you have three shootings in a night, that ties up several cars and there's a huge backlog. So in that respect, I think that there is value in adding to the police force. I know the Chicago Police Department is also hiring civilian analysts in this expansion to try to combine both, you know, human intelligence and more of some of the data background that we tried to explore with this report. So I think the expansion will be interesting and I think probably contribute to some sort of, you know, violence reduction, hopefully this year.
Well, Chip, what do you hear from police officers and folks in the criminal justice community about that? Is it not just a question of more, but how?
Yeah, the promise is to expand the police department by 970 sworn officers by the end of next year. That's on top of replacing people that retire, you know, attrition. Right. Mm-hmm. Now, included in that number is are 200 detectives, growing the force by 200 detectives. And I think that an argument could be made, and what I hear from a lot of people, and you know, from researchers, from cops, from people who live in the neighborhoods, is that more detectives and better relations with the community to solve more murders and solve other major crimes would go a long way to, you know, in preventive terms as well. Mm-hmm. We reported first the story that Chicago's murder clearance rate, that is, you know, there are a couple ways to measure it, but no matter how you measure it, it reached an historic low last year. So if the number of murders solved, basically it's not exactly solved, but solved by that were committed last year and solved during the year was 19.8%. Mm-hmm. And so less than one in five murders committed in the year was somebody brought to justice, you know, was somebody at least arrested and charged. That is mind-blowing. Mm-hmm. And if more of the killers can be held responsible, I think that would go a long way. So I'm not sure that it's actually, you know, I don't know. I think it's an open question whether 200 detectives is the key. You know, if there is that person power shortage, a manpower shortage there with detectives, or is it more stronger relationships between the police department and the community to mm-hmm. solve these murders? Mm-hmm. I think that's an open question, but I would say, that would be a place to focus. If there are resources and if there are things to fix, getting more murders solved would be, you know, at the top of, could, there's a strong argument that that should be at the top of the list.
Well, if you want to respond.
Yeah, I just wanted to say that I also think it depends on what those cops will be doing. I had an interesting conversation with the police community liaison. I can't think of his name right now, but he was telling me that they had this pilot program where they were not only just arresting people, because it doesn't do a lot of good just to arrest people and throw them in jail and have them out again, you know, in 3 months or 2 weeks or however long, but to provide services to the young people they arrest, if they're not in school, to try to help them get back in school, if they need counseling, to provide counseling. You know, there are even situations where they are coming from homes where there's no food in the home and things like that. So I would love to see cops not just throwing more people in jail, but trying to address some of the needs that are out there in the community. And I think that as far as building community trust and support from the community, that would go a long way.
We have other questions. Yes.
One of the questions we were asked about the why earlier, one of the things I was thinking about would access to mental health services be helpful in addressing some of these issues that are happening on the Southwest side? I don't know if there's a lot, my guess is probably no, but if there were increased services, medical services, but also mental health services, might that have some impact?
I think the one thing that, because of the power.
Let me repeat that for everybody. So if you didn't hear the question, she was asking, would some of the violence issues be better addressed if there were more mental health services in neighborhoods, in the neighborhoods that are most affected by the violence?
One of the women that I spoke to a couple months ago, her son had been shot. He was 18. She said he had issues, psychiatric issues, and their neighborhood mental health center where he used to go He'd gone there for drug rehab, and he'd gone there for counseling when he got thrown out of school, had closed. And she didn't have a car, and they lived on the far south side, so there's not great public transportation down there. She said she had nowhere to take him. She didn't know what to do with him. So I think, I know when some of the budget cuts came down from the state, a lot of those small community kind of mental health centers and counseling centers, those kinds of things, were the first things that were hit. Now they've opened a few new ones, but they're more regional, and I don't think they realize a lot of these people can't, they just can't get there. They don't have a good way to get there, or they're afraid to go out and get there. So I think there's the, at least the psychiatric part of it, having those more of those small neighborhood centers would be a very good thing. And I think that's one of the things that is being talked about. I just don't see the money coming down to do it yet.
I just wanted to add that when you talk to some of these young people, almost every one of them that I have talked to has said to me,
we have to wrap it up,
okay,
I guess.
Okay. I don't care if I live or die.
Yeah.
That I'm not afraid to die. Mm-hmm. They expect that they're gonna die. I think a lot of these kids are suffering from PTSD. I mean, they've seen so much. It's so emotional for them. There's no outlet for them to release, you know, what they're feeling and their fears and that kind of thing. So any kind of services along those lines, I think, would be helpful because they're just immune mm-hmm. to the violence, it seems.
I don't have anything to add. I think, yeah, a lot of people are really traumatized, and trauma is a huge issue, and there's a big need for more mental health services.
Kim, do you have, okay. Do we have
one thing, yeah. You mentioned PTSD. Mm-hmm. Northwestern just did a study, and I was just reading it. We're going to do a story on it at some point, but they went to just one neighborhood. They said one of the neighborhoods affected by violence. They didn't specify the neighborhood in the information on the study, but they said 50% of the people they interviewed had been either traumatized by the death of a family member, mm-hmm. the shooting death of a family member. They had been physically assaulted or shot, or they had been sexually assaulted in some way. And they said 75% of those people showed symptoms of PTSD. And if that's true, I have friends who have PTSD, and it's a scary, scary thing. And again, it goes to the lack, I think, of they don't have anywhere to go. If you went into a hospital and said, I have PTSD because of my neighborhood, I don't know that any insurance company is going to cover that.
Right.
Maybe if you're a veteran, yeah, but, mm-hmm. and those people need counseling. That's what they need. A lot of them need counseling, and they just don't have anywhere to go and get it.
I mean, I want to add to that because it is a question of services, but there's also this evolving work in, you know, the field of trauma. There's a woman named Monica Williams in Louisville, Kentucky, who's been arguing to include racialized violence, which you could say is everything from, you know, lynchings to the disproportionate number of black people shot by officers, to have that included as a part of, of post-traumatic stress disorder, because there's some attempt to resist seeing that as part of this larger area. So while you need services, there's also just this whole evolving field that's trying to understand that type of trauma is very much the same type of, not the same, but it should be included as post-traumatic stress disorder. And that's a fight to have that frame changed. So I want to see if there are any other questions. Yes.
I wanted to know better, or to better understand, what do journal, well, especially journalists, right? So,
except Kim.
So, what do you all mean when you say to invest money into these communities? What does it mean when you say, and policymakers also, you know, say to build better relationships between the cops and the community? Because mm-hmm. I feel from what I've seen, especially with certain media as well, is that the relationships or the definitions of what that they mean are not exactly what these communities need. Like, to invest money automatically, to me, brings up gentrification, which means pushing the people away from those communities. And I feel like the people in those communities already are people that have lost the feeling of ownership of their community. And then building these relationships between the cops and the community, I've seen media outlets showing pictures of cops with picnics and kids and things like that. And it's like, people are saying that that's not what the community needs. So, like, what do people mean by this is truly what it is that we need? Like, I want to know a better definition of that.
And then can, after they answer that, can I flip it back on you and ask you what you think ought to happen? Okay, so let's go.
I think when, and I want to talk about putting money back into the community. If you've been to some of these communities, you realize they're a long way from gentrification. I'm just talking about fixing some roofs, painting some houses, mowing some lawns, fixing some fences, cleaning up some empty lots, cleaning up some alleys, just painting stripes in the streets. Just make it look better than it does now, and I think that in itself is not going to solve the problem. But if you can make people a little more proud of the community they live in, that'll go a long way to at least uplift them a little bit. They also need to put money into, if they could put money, small business loans into some of the businesses down there so they could hire more kids. I don't know what the unemployment rate down there is in some of those areas, but I would go back to the study, and it's probably the young black men in those communities have probably one of the highest unemployment rates in the city, if not in the nation. Put money into small business loans, put money into improving the houses and the streets, you know, better street lights, more police cameras, better parks, just things that the people, one thing that got to me, the last three people that I've spoken to whose family members had died were all at the time that their family member died were planning to move out of Chicago. They just didn't have the money to do it right away. I get people saying, why don't they just move? What? For some people, yeah, they move all the time, but if you don't have any money and you don't have anywhere to go and your whole family is here in Chicago, I mean, you can't just pack up and hit the road. But putting money into the streets, into the parks, into improving the houses, open those schools again. Like I said before, a lot of those neighborhoods, when you lose a school, I've seen it happen to small towns in Indiana. The school closes, and in 10 years, that town's basically gone. There's nothing left. That's the center of those communities. That's where the kids go for programs, for playing, for anything. If they don't have a school, a lot of those communities feel like they don't have anything. That's what I mean when I say put money back into the community. Just improve what's there. You don't need to gentrify. I don't mean tear those houses down and build a bunch of houses that they can't afford to live in. That's not going to happen immediately. Just fix up what's there and make it more presentable, more livable, more, I don't know the word I want to use.
Well, the second part of the question was, let me repeat the question first, and I think this may have to be our last, is the question of how do you improve without gentrifying? How do you invest without gentrifying? And what do you mean when you say better relations between the police and the community? So that's the second part of the question.
I am not an expert on housing and gentrification and so on. But my understanding is that nationwide, and especially in Chicago, the neighborhoods that gentrify are not African American neighborhoods generally. I think white people with money don't want to live with African Americans with resources, and they tend to gentrify neighborhoods occupied by Latinos. Mm-hmm. I think that's the general pattern. There are probably, I'm sure there are some exceptions. So I've been here for, this is my 11th year in Chicago, and I've been hearing the whole time about how East Garfield Park and North Lawndale, because they have such great access to public transportation and proximity mm-hmm. to downtown, and you know, the conservatories there, and how they're going to gentrify, or they already are, and I actually don't see it happening. I haven't seen any either indicators, or and I haven't definitely haven't eyeballed it when I'm on my bike or in my car, you know. So you know, Pilsen and Hummel Park and Logan Square, Westtown, you know, very different stories. But mm-hmm. I don't think that those were ever mainly occupied by African Americans, at least mm-hmm. recently in the last few decades.
Can I just say something about the police relations? One of the things the Justice Department found when they came in and looked at what was going here after the Laquan day, Laquan McDonald mm-hmm. case, was that something that people in the neighborhoods have known forever, that police are more likely to harass mm-hmm. People in certain neighborhoods. They're more likely to disrespect people when they are even making, you know, surveying communities or what have you. And people have been complaining about that for years. And the report confirmed that it has always fallen on deaf ears, that no one paid attention to that. So when we talk about improving relations between the community, you can't really expect that someone is going to run up to the police and, you know, offer their help on a case if they don't trust the police. So you've got to build that trust between the community and the police. And you know, it's easy to stand back and say, yeah, you know, they should be doing this. But we talked about this before, it's also very dangerous. So really, when you are reporting information you might have on a crime, your life may be at risk. You have to believe that the police have your best interest at heart and that they are going to make it worth your while, you know, to present that information, because, you know, you could be killed. And that's a real danger. That's not made up. I was covering a trial one time, and it was a gang member who had killed another gang member. And in the back of the courtroom, there were these young men who came in, and the entire time, one of the witnesses, who was a member of one of the gangs, was testifying. He was sitting back there, you know, with a, you know, making his fingers and like pointing a gun at him from the back of the courtroom. So this kind of stuff happens, and you know, you've got to be able to trust the authorities.
Just to add to what exactly does improved community police relations look like? Again, going back to the time I've spent in the Harrison District on the west side, I think there are, you know, very concrete action items going into effect with CPD, and I do see value in community events, community cleanups after, for example, narcotics roundups, you know, friendly interactions, foot patrol, you know, police visiting businesses, taking, you know, action after shots are fired and canvassing the area, following up with people. There are, I think, initiatives in the works that actually do go they push you in the right direction regarding legitimacy on both sides. So I think there's a lot of work to be done, certainly in Chicago, but I do see value in, I think, a lot of the tactics that may seem superfluous.
So what do you think?
Well, I really like your idea, how you were talking about just cleaning up the community, because I feel like that's true. When you live in a community where your own city doesn't care about how it looks, it makes you feel more like, if I pay my taxes and they still don't find me as someone that's important enough to be able to have a clean street, then I'm not gonna do anything about it. Then other people are more like, well, you know, if they don't value me as much, I feel valueless, and so I kind of just don't do anything in that way too. I do wish that, I don't know if it's something that I learned based on the way that our communities work or the way that our society works, but I feel like if maybe we were more allowed or more given the idea that it is okay for other people outside of those communities to come into those communities and help out those communities. Because sometimes I pass by those communities a lot. I have family that live out in the South, so I pass by those communities. And I always wondered, would it be okay to just step out of my car and just pick up garbage? Like, there's no reason for me to ask for people, like, hey, come and watch me to pick up garbage or come help me out. Like, can't I just do that? And I wish that there was a feeling of it's okay, if it is okay, to just go and join in and do all of that. And in regards to, like, the police communication and things, I feel like how you were saying with those ideas of really what that sounds like to me is just building that trust means to be more, what do you call it? Do not break promises you cannot keep. What's that word that also means that? So like, if the cops say that what they need to be doing is that they need to be in X, Y, and Z at a certain time, that they're gonna do that in every single neighborhood.
Accountability.
Accountability and being respectful of the people in the community, I think would go a long way.
Be consistent with that in all types of neighborhoods.
Okay.
But is it cool for me to just do that? Like, in regards to the whole neighborhood? Or are you saying that this really should be more?
No, I think part of the problem is the West Side people have their own ideas, the North Side people have their own ideas. They need to all come together in some kind of forum besides a city council meeting where they already know what they're going to spend their money on. They're going to spend it on the Riverwalk, or they're going to spend it on, you know, whatever, you know, or do we need a new bicycle trail up somewhere? There's just not that kind of forum for you know, like we talked, somebody mentioned before having meetings in all 50 wards. But inviting people from other, you know, from other areas to come talk at those meetings and get everyone together. And just that's what I don't see happening anywhere in Chicago, some kind of forum where everybody can come and say what you want. I know the logistics make that hard. They could do it, you know, on a maybe a Facebook thing or something, but I think, you know, people in all the neighborhoods, they all have the same problems. Basically the same problems. They all have the same needs. They just don't, it's like, I don't trust you because you live in a different, you know, you live five blocks away. I don't trust you. There's just not that interaction. And that's part of what the problem needs to be. The public doesn't trust the police, but they also don't trust each other. A lot of people don't trust anyone who's not from their neighborhood. And I think that would go a long way in, you know, if the public could get together and decide what they want, then they could pressure the city council to, hey, this is what we want you to do. Not each ward clawing and scratching for what little bit they can get.
Well, I think that we have hit our time limit, so that is going to have to be the last word. Thank you for joining us this evening, and thank you for your questions. I want to thank the panelists for being with us as well.